Let's start with some relevant biographical remarks. Not that many people are familiar with Lacan, so I prefer to ease into today's lecture rather than just start talking about complicated Lacanian concepts. In 1919, Lacan starts studying medicine in the Paris Medical Faculty. Nothing particularly interesting about that. However, the next year, something important happens. Through André Breton, Lacan gets acquainted with the surrealists and becomes involved with the surrealist movement. As we will see later, surrealism helped shape some of Lacan's ideas. Lacan's fascination by the surrealists was a linguistic fascination. Thanks to the surrealists, he realized that any conjunction of two signifiers could just as easily constitute a metaphor. We have a quote here from Lacan, which reads, "The surrealist school led us to take a major step forward." In October 1933, Lacan attends Kojève's seminar on Hegel's Phenomenology of Spirit. Kojève turns out to be a major influence on Lacan. Without Kojève, Lacan would have not developed many of his ideas. We will go into much detail later to talk about the consequences of this influence. In 1938, Lacan finishes his analysis and becomes a full member of the Société Psychanalytique de Paris. In January 1953, he becomes the president of the Société Psychanalytique de Paris, but he resigns 5 months later. Instead, he joins Société Française de Psychanalyse. Unfortunately, the members of Société Française de Psychanalyse realize that they are no longer a member of the International Psychoanalytical Association. The group had to seek affiliation. After a lengthy process, they were told that they would be granted membership on the condition that Lacan be removed from his position as a training analyst. As you can probably guess, the majority accepted the term. This in turn led Lacan to found his own psychoanalytic school, which became known as École Freudienne de Paris. It wasn't all bad news for Lacan, because this act promoted him as a lone intellectual. Why was the International Psychoanalytical Association opposed to Lacan? The major contributor to the criticism was Lacan's unique method of variable length sessions. The criticism goes all the way back to 1951, when Lacan introduces the innovation. Lacan was the first person to come up with this method and be rigorous about it. I mean, after Freud. Not everyone was a big fan of his method, but Lacan insisted that conducting sessions of variable length is true to the Freudian spirit. And on so many levels, this makes sense. If you're in analysis and you're making progress, it would be ridiculous to stop the session in the middle of the progress because of some arbitrarily agreed upon length of time. The session could last 20 minutes, 2 hours, or even more. The length does not matter. What matters is the progress that is being made during the session. Nevertheless, despite the obvious advantages of this innovation, the Société Psychanalytique de Paris and later the International Psychoanalytical Association were strongly opposed to it. Also, to play the devil's advocate here, Lacan took this method from Freud, but we need to be fair because Lacan overlooked the fact that Freud was doing experiments. If you're conducting an experiment, your experiment should go on as long as it needs to. It would be really stupid to stop the experiment after 1 hour, despite you're making progress. So anyway, Lacan overlooked this fact, but he did have some points. So that was some biographical information, so you would get acquainted with Lacan, and now that I can tell that you are mesmerized, I can continue. So let's examine the general outline of Lacanian psychoanalysis. From the very beginning, when his career was starting to take off, Lacan kept emphasizing on a return to Freud. Lacan saw a return to Freud as something quite important and urgent. In his view, analysts always need to go back to Freud and reread him until they understand what Freud had to say. There are multiple reasons for this. One of them is that Lacan associates truth with Freud. He says we need to go back to Freud because there are certain truths in Freud and everyone is interested in truths. We need to know what those truths are, and without rereading Freud, they will remain undiscovered. The second reason, which is much more related to what we're going to talk about today, is language. Later, we will see how language is related to the symbolic. For Lacan, truth and language are interconnected. In fact, there is no truth without language. You cannot step outside of language and examine or talk about truths. So truth happens in language. We could still say there is a third reason behind Lacan's insistence on a return to Freud, and it has to do with the difference between the hard sciences, and by which I mean physics or mathematics, and other fields such as psychoanalysis. Let me clarify what I mean. When you go to school, they teach you mathematics and physics. The way they teach you such disciplines is by talking about their formulae and their implications. In high school, you learn how to work with Newtonian physics, but your physics teacher never tells you to read Newton's Principia Mathematica. Summaries and the formulae suffice. No one has to read Newton in the original Latin. Such a demand wouldn't even make any sense. But obviously, this is not the case with psychoanalysis or philosophy. If you're interested in Heidegger, you should learn German and read Heidegger in the original. If you're interested in Plato, you should learn ancient Greek. You cannot become a true Marxist without having read what Marx wrote. It does not matter if you're a non-Marxist or you live in the 21st century, you would still have to read what Marx actually wrote. The same is true of psychoanalysis. No matter how much progress and advancement have been made in psychoanalysis, a psychoanalyst should always read Freud in order to be considered a true psychoanalyst. That's the whole idea behind returning to Freud, which Lacan puts forward. There is a relevant quotation: we can do no better than return to Freud's work. In its original context, that's actually some advice Lacan is giving to psychoanalysts in general. Um, And I really like this quote because it just shows Lacan's megalomania. He says, Freud never really knew what he was doing. A return to Freud's texts shows, on the contrary, the absolute coherence between his technique and his discovery. And this coherence allows us to situate his procedures at the proper level. So basically what Lacan is getting at is that Freud discovered some truth, perhaps by chance, but he was not clever enough to understand what he had discovered. The whole reason behind the existence of the International Psychoanalytical Association was to preserve Freud's texts until someone smart enough, like Lacan, came along and reread Freud. I think it takes courage to claim that the father of psychoanalysis did not know what he was doing. In any case, the funny thing is that Lacan also believed that even Freud's daughter, Anna Freud, did not understand what his father was doing. In his opinion, she was just another tool that helped the preservation of Freud's text. In fact, Lacan extensively criticizes Anna Freud's understanding, or should I say lack of understanding, of psychoanalysis. What we've said so far was just an introduction. Now begins the real theoretical talk. This is called the Borromean knot. It is in fact the Lacanian triad of the imaginary, the symbolic, and the real. What you see here is at the heart of Lacanian psychoanalysis. Without this, you cannot get anywhere in reading Lacan. Because according to Lacan, our perception of reality is structured based on this topological structure. It needs to be said that Lacan uses this knot as a metaphor. He wants to show us that how the three orders are interconnected. In his 20th seminar, Lacan tells us the way that this topology works is that if you unravel one of the circles, the whole structure will fall apart. As a matter of fact, in one of his essays, Lacan talks about a case in which the symbolic somehow becomes suspended in the patient, leading to a shift from the symbolic to the dyadic relation between the imaginary and the real. As a consequence, the patient experiences hallucinations and other similar phenomena. That's how important the symbolic is in maintaining our sense of reality. And due to its importance, we will talk about the symbolic in great length today. What you see here is more or less an outline of Lacan's career. In the 30s and the 40s, he was focusing on the imaginary. Then there was a shift of emphasis to the symbolic, which started in the 50s until he finally moved on to the real in the 60s and the 70s. I need to say that despite the dates written here, in reality, the outline of his career is not as clear-cut. For instance, although the 50s is considered to be the decade of the symbolic, Lacan still talks about the imaginary a lot during this period, especially in his first and second seminars. There are multiple reasons for this. For example, in his first seminar, he talks about the imaginary because he wants to show why people like Anna Freud were wrong. In other words, he is only forced to talk about the imaginary in order to show the importance of the symbolic. He wants to show that if you only rely on the imaginary, you will miss the whole picture. As you can see, there is also a strange category here, which is called lesintam. Lesintam was meant to extend the triad to form a tetrad. Overall, it proved to be a problematic concept as it didn't neatly fit into the picture. That's why later Lacanian psychoanalysts more or less abandoned the idea, and when people nowadays talk about the structure of our reality, they mainly focus on this triad and they treat lesintam separately. Let me give you an example so you will better understand what lesintam is. Lesintam is basically meaningless enjoyment. The other form of the word which people are more familiar with is symptom. And we all know what symptom means. When you say, for example, the patient shows such and such a symptom, we know what it means. We go see a doctor or an analyst in the hope that they would interpret our symptoms. The crucial point is that symptoms are interpretable. After all, that's why we go to doctors in the first place. The symptom, however, does not need to be interpreted. You might ask, what's the point of it then? Lacan himself saw the end of analysis as when the patient identifies with the symptom. But later interpreters of Lacan applied this concept to other domains such as politics. In Lacanian psychoanalysis, there is a difference between acting out and what Lacan calls passage à l'acte. Acting out is an action that the subject performs as an action. This action is potentially analyzable and interpretable, and it's the job of the analyst to analyze it. For instance, at this very moment, I'm giving a lecture, and it seems that you are the audience here. But this is only an appearance. According to Lacan, the real audience of my lecture is the figure of the big other. I will tell you who the big other is soon, but for now, keep in mind that based on an analyst's interpretation of my actions are directed toward another being. This helps the analyst to reveal the real motives behind my actions. These motives are, of course, unconscious. It is these motives that make me do what I do. Only the big other knows the reasons behind my actions, and the analyst may discover them if he is smart enough. In other words, every action that I perform is a coded message that is waiting to be deciphered by the big other. But that's not the case with passage à l'acte. Passage à l'acte is an action that someone performs just for the sake of that action. So in a political context, when riots take place and when people protest, there is usually no rational reason behind people's behavior. Most people just react to the situation. Not every protester has read political philosophy or analyzed the economic situation from an economist's point of view before they became outraged. No, they just simply react, and they don't even know what has led them to the situation in which they are. In such situations, their real worry would be if people actually manage to overthrow the government, because the question they would have to face would be, now what? The fact of the matter is that riots and protests are meaningless reactions, and we can categorize them as passage à l'acte. Okay. Let's move on. I want to tell you about the shift from the imaginary to the symbolic that took place during the 50s in Lacan's thinking. This shift can be expressed as the movement from the small other to the big other. What does that mean? In Lacan's work, from time to time you may come across certain symbols that are known as Lacanian mathems, which are used in Lacanian algebra. For the purpose of our discussion, it's not really important to know how Lacan used his pseudo-algebra. The only thing you need to know is that in Lacanian psychoanalysis, the symbol or the matheme used to represent a concrete individual, like each of you to whom I can talk and with whom I can interact, is a lowercase, italicized A. The individual represented by A, or to use the psychoanalytic term, the ego, is located in the imaginary order. In contrast to the small other, there is also the abstract figure known as the big other, which is located in the symbolic order. There. The matheme for the big other is an uppercase A. Lacan calls this figure an invisible figure. So now it should be clear what is meant from the movement from the small other to the big other. It's a movement from autre with a lowercase a to autre with an uppercase a. It's a shift from the ego to the abstract invisible figure. I will tell you what that figure is in a bit, don't worry. But before we move on, I just would like to emphasize that reality should not in any case be confused with the real. The real is something else. Reality, if you want to know where you should locate reality, it's in the symbolic, not in the real. Just to repeat myself, reality and the real are not the same thing. Now I'm going to focus on the imaginary to explain what it is. Then we're going to work our way through the symbolic and the real after that. If you're already familiar with Lacan, what you might have heard of is the mirror stage. Some people believe that the mirror stage is the most original idea Lacan ever had. The mirror stage does not actually have to involve a mirror. It refers to a stage in the development of humans. More specifically, this stage is located in childhood, when the child realizes for the first time that, oh, I'm a self, you know, in this world. I can recognize myself in the mirror. And I can recognize other people as other people, not just as parts of myself. According to Lacan, if a child sees another person in front of itself, it will start to identify with that person. There are two kinds of identification at this point. Identification with an older person who is seen as a model for the child, such as a parent, or identification with another child of the same age. What we are talking about here is identification with another child. This process of identification is required for the child to be able to construct his own identity. The child's ego is developed based on its identification with the other. Hence the importance of this stage. The mirror stage is a crucial part of childhood, but we never really grow out of it when we become adults. Even as adults, we can establish our identity based on what other people want. In this period of Lacan's work, we can identify the huge influence Kojève had made on him. Kojève's understanding of Hegel is at the heart of Lacan's thinking when it comes to identity and interaction with others. In his famous seminar on Hegel's Phenomenology of Spirit, Kojève talks a lot about desire and the relation between master and slave, or to use a Hegelian jargon, the dialectic of the master and the slave. These ideas found their way into Lacanian psychoanalysis. So let's go through some of Kojève's arguments. In his seminar, Kojève writes that in the world there need to be at least two people so the relation between the master and the slave could be established. This relation is established when they get into a fight for pure prestige. Is it written there? I'll probably start writing the important words on the blackboard. Can you actually read it? The fight for pure prestige, let's have that for now. Where was I? So, one of the two, when two people get into the fight for pure prestige, one of the two will end up as the master, and then this automatically means that the other person who has lost the fight will be the slave, obviously. The problem is that at the end of the fight, the slave will recognize the master as the master, but the master will not recognize the slave as the slave. Because in his opinion, the slave is something beneath human. He is not even human. He could even think of him as a thing. Or at first, the master will view the slave as an animal. So, the slave is not viewed as human. I hope you can see the psychological considerations that Kojève is taking into account in this simple story. The psychological considerations become much stronger as we move on, as we go on. In his seminar, Kojève talks about desire, which is absolutely crucial to Lacanian psychoanalysis. We all know what biological desires are. Think of animals and their desires. When an animal has a desire, it wants a thing. And the satisfaction of desire is achieved by the consumption of that thing. To generalize, in animals, desire is always directed at a thing. Crucially, the thing at which the animal's desire is directed is biologically important for the animal. Without it, the animal either dies or does not fulfill its biological purpose. The biological significance of this desires is obvious. When an animal is hungry, it wants food. When it's thirsty, it wants water. And when it's sexually frustrated, it wants sex. However, this is not the case with humans. Something far more interesting happens in us humans. Yes, we have such primordial needs like other animals, and we can direct our desires to what satisfies those needs. But we also do something extra. We have the ability to direct our desire to desire itself. In other words, we can desire another desire. By directing desire to another desire, one desires desire for the sake of desire. As a matter of fact, that's what sparks the whole fight for pure prestige. Desire directed toward a natural object is human only to the extent that it is mediated by the desire of another directed toward the same object. It is human to desire what others desire because they desire it. Thus, an object perfectly useless from the biological point of view, such as a medal or an enemy's flag, can be desired because it is the object of other desires. Such a desire can only be a human desire and human reality, as distinguished from animal reality, is created only by action that satisfies such desires. As a Marxist, Kojève took into account the society as a whole. He says, if the human reality is a social reality, society is human only as a set of desires, mutually desiring one another as desires. At this point, you may want to ask how important all of this is for understanding Lacan. The answer is very important. The whole reason I've been telling you about Kojève is that, first of all, Lacan's ideas about social interaction and the formation of personal identity were based on Kojève's analysis of Hegel. Secondly, Lacan has a famous phrase which reads, desire is the desire of the other. This is quite important, and you often see it in here and there. Based on what we said, you should know what this phrase means and where it comes from. What the subject desires is always something that someone else desires. That's why useless things have social values. Things such as honor do not have any biological purpose, but many people risk their lives in the name of honor. Doesn't that sound paradoxical? That being said, desiring the desire of the other is not limited to fighting for pure prestige. We have a passage here which is identical to how Lacan explains the relation between the lover and the beloved. In the relationship between man and a woman, for example, desire is human only if the one desires not the body but the desire of the other. If he wants to possess or to assimilate the desire taken as desire. I hope by now you can see the importance of desire. Well, we have another relevant quote. Human history is the history of desires. If you compare Kojève's seminar with some of Lacan's writings, you will see how similar the two are. In some instances, it seems that Lacan is just paraphrasing Kojève in an abstract manner without giving him any credit. This is easy to see in the example which I give you, like desire is the desire of the other. The concrete individuals of Kojève's society become the invisible figure of the big other in Lacan. It's just strange because he never gives credit to Kojève. I don't know why. If there are no questions, we can move on to the real. No questions? Then we move on. To put it in one sentence, the real is that which is beyond the symbolic. What do we mean by this? I will explain what I mean by talking about fantasy, and hopefully you will see why the real is located beyond the symbolic. We have a quote which reads, fantasy protects the real. Fantasy protects the real. Let's interpret this phrase. Lacan believes that the real is too traumatic for us. Humans deal with this traumatic experience by symbolizing what is otherwise meaningless. That's yet another difference between animals and humans. Animals lack the ability to symbolize the real. Symbolization is the whole function of language and other symbolic structures, such as the social structure of law. To get back to the phrase we have in front of us, fantasy is also something that belongs to the symbolic, and it is one of the ways through which we symbolize the real. Fantasy is constructed around a gap that has been left open in the symbolic register. The gap itself belongs to the real, and it is experienced as something traumatic for the subject. The subject tries to avoid getting into close contact with the real. How can we know where to look for this gap in the symbolic? Well, this gap is located where the subject returns to it. Of course, this is not a physical location. It is rather a psychical location. Every time the subject returns to it, he or she attempts to symbolize the gap. However, normally such attempts are doomed to failure, and the whole process has to be repeated, leading to another failure and another repetition. Okay, so just imagine, I don't know, this is the symbolic field. Wait a minute. We have the symbolic field here, which you do not see because this marker doesn't write, but in any case, there is a gap here. This is the gap in the symbolic, and this... Okay, that one works. Thank you. So this gap belongs to the symbolic... this is the symbolic field, and the gap belongs to the real. There is nothing there, it's empty. The subject keeps returning to it. It's the traumatic thing for the subject. Let's ask a simple question. What does trauma mean in psychoanalysis? Everyone talks about trauma. Nowadays, people use the term so often that the word trauma has lost its potency. The word trauma has a different meaning in Lacanian psychoanalysis than it does in everyday conversation. To To understand what trauma means, you need to take into consideration your whole idea of the reality and how you make sense of the world around you. You need to think about your life and describe your everydayness to yourself. If you're an average person, by analyzing your life, you will realize that your everydayness is not that exciting. Nothing out of the ordinary happens in your life. This is in itself not a bad thing, because everydayness is usually experienced as something cozy and safe, and we would like to keep it that way. Now, if all of a sudden, something radical happens and something radically disturbs your everydayness in a way that you cannot make sense of it. In this case, you will have experienced trauma. The traumatic experience is what throws your life out of balance. When this happens, you won't be able to give a coherent account of your life anymore. Why? Because the trauma introduces an unexplainable gap into the symbolic order. From this moment on, you won't be able to think about your life in the same way you used to think about it prior to the traumatic experience. As long as the gap remains open, trauma will persist. Where does psychoanalysis come into play? Imagine that you go to an analyst and you start talking to the analyst about your life, your childhood, and so on. After some sessions, it becomes obvious that you are not able to talk about certain things with your analyst. About things which you might not even know what they are. It is the job of the analyst to figure out what those things are, or at least to figure out which concepts are related to them. What you cannot talk about is where your traumas are. It is important to note that we all have such traumas. Without traumas, we cannot possibly be human. Everyone has traumas. Let's redefine the problem. What happens when you cannot talk about something? The simple answer is
that your memory fails.
In other words, you reach the limits of your memory. The cliche that people have in mind when they talk about psychoanalysis is that you go to an analyst, then miraculously, after some sessions, you recover some hidden memories that were lost to you, and you suddenly remember parts of your childhood. Well, Lacan says that's just not possible. According to Lacan, that's just nonsense. No such thing is possible if those so-called memories are formed around a traumatic experience. Why?
Well, think about how we form memories.
Before we can form memories of an event or of a thing, you need to make sense of that thing. In other words, it needs to become symbolized. If we cannot symbolize it, there will be no memory of it. To give you an example, when you are walking home from school or from your office, sometimes you are deep in your thoughts and you cannot remember how you got home. During the whole trip, you were on autopilot and you were not conscious of your surroundings, which means you did not symbolize anything. Therefore, you cannot remember anything. Or imagine you watch a film in Swedish. If you don't speak any Swedish, you won't be able to make a sense of what people are saying during the movie. Therefore, you won't be able to remember the dialogue. The point is that symbolization is it's a crucial part of forming memories.
Trauma works in the same way. If you don't symbolize an event for some reason whatsoever,
you won't be able to remember it.
Consequently, no matter how hard your analyst may try during your psychoanalytic sessions, he won't be able to help you remember anything. As you can see, Lacanian psychoanalysis is not really anything like what people normally have in mind when they talk about psychoanalysis in general. When Lacan formalized his approach to trauma and memories, he was influenced by the philosopher Kierkegaard. In one of his works, which is titled Repetition,
let's just write it in case you're interested in that. You can read it, it's a nice work. It's a novel, basically. It's not that
Kierkegaard proposes that repetition and recollection are two sides of the same coin. He claims memory is just backward repetition. Lacan criticizes this Kierkegaardian interpretation of memory because if you think about it, the process cannot be as simple as Kierkegaard describes it. If memory were just backward repetition, you could access all your memories. You would only need to trace your steps backward to reach those memories. But as we just explained a minute ago, this is not possible. There is a limit to backward repetition, and that limit is the real. In Lacanian psychoanalysis, repetition is something else. Repetition means returning over and over again to the traumatic point. This would be repetition. This is the summary of what we've been talking about. Just to summarize, the imaginary is the dimension of the surfaces and appearances, in other words, the visual aspect of things. The symbolic is the dimension of the already signified. It is, in a sense, the lingual dimension. And the third is the real. And the real is that which has remained not signified. It is the real that it is in the real that things are in their neutral form, devoid of any significance.